I'm Bregtje van der Haak. I'm a documentary director, director of DNA Dreams, a film about the frontier of genomics research in China and a group of young researchers who are looking for the genes that are responsible for IQ.
Il y a dans ce flacon une substance qui est plus précieuse que l'or, les diamants ou le pétrole du monde réuni. Cette substance, les Anglais l'appellent le DNA.
Very recently, I would say the past 3 years, China has invested heavily in DNA sequencing capacity, which is a very different thing from the full rounded field of genetic research. So you could say that the machinery park for DNA sequencing, the largest machinery park, is now in China, in Shenzhen. So that's just a matter of money. I mean, anyone who invests capital can buy sequencers. When we started the film, the plan was that BGI, the Cognitive Genomics Laboratory, would collect 2,000 DNA samples of very intelligent Chinese children. And first I didn't understand what was taking so long, but then it turned out they were really having trouble because both parents and schools were really suspicious, like, what were they going to do with this DNA? And the children are very precious, of course, as you know, and they wanted to be sure that nothing would happen to them, that their privacy would be respected, and they couldn't really be sure because it's really new, they didn't know BGI. So in the end, this became more and more of a burden on the project, and they decided to widen the project into an international collaboration. In the end, the main samples, I believe 1,000 samples, are coming from Project Talent, a long study in America. The Chinese scientists were telling me, look, you know, this pig, this life, is life that I created under my microscope. In Chinese culture, that's a perfectly acceptable thing to say. And the researcher who told me, she felt very proud of that. She said, I feel like a mother because I created this life under my microscope. Now, an American or a European researcher wouldn't say that very easily, because even though many people are non-believers now in Western societies, it's still a Christian culture. So there is still this sort of uneasiness about the idea that anybody besides God would be a creator of life. I think since China has had a one-child policy for 30 years now, the idea of the awareness maybe, or the interest in the embryo, and knowing whether it's a boy or a girl, but also trying to think about, you know, whether it's in good health, is it growing well, is it the best possible child that you are growing in your belly, is much different from in Europe, I would say. And therefore, I think that the step from, well, of course, also the abortion of girl fetuses, it's happening, even though it's not allowed, it's happening. I can easily imagine that the step towards screening embryos for intelligence, once that knowledge would be available, and then maybe aborting if the intelligence, the IQ, is too low, wouldn't be a science fiction scenario. I can imagine that becoming a reality. And that's where it starts to make me feel uneasy. The researchers talk about what could they do possibly if they have the results from this big sequencing action. And one of them is saying, look, it wouldn't hurt us to be a little bit smarter on average.
I've sometimes explained to people how this is obviously the most realistic vision of how things will be.
Right.
I'm just basically explaining how the embryo selection will work and how I've been planning to do this since I was a kid, when I have kids.
Right.
And this is even...
was the problem, you know, we do have abortion of babies with Down syndrome. It's widely accepted now, which is something like very low IQ, you could say. So what's the problem? I think the problem is not on an individual level. I think it's very good for everyone. It's easier to be smarter rather than dumber. But I think the risks are on a collective scale. Well, what kind of society are we creating where technologies are available to make a selection at the entrance of life, so to say, those who get in and those who don't get in. What about those who cannot afford the selection process to get in the right shape? Will we create a society that is less tolerant of weakness or of lower IQ? What will insurance companies do once that technology is available? I think those things are worrying. Yeah, for the collective, for the society, I think it would create tensions. Because it's not, once the knowledge is there, it doesn't mean that the cure or the selection or the improvements will be available equally for everyone. It will create new inequalities. Some people will have access to these technologies and other people will not. So that's what worries me. I think it also really brings good. I think it's definitely not only bad. And I didn't make the documentary to say, look at this, it's horrible, you know, stop it. That's not my goal. But I think now, since the developments in science are so fast, it's mainly scientists who are educated about it and they're excited, they're involved, they push the frontier, which is good on the one hand, but societies are going to be affected. We're all going to be affected. Yes, and they can't get up. Regulators cannot catch up. Politicians don't know what's going on. So citizens don't know. I think it needs to be a wider awareness of advances in science so we can decide what do we want to do with these technologies and what do we want to avoid.